events across the Middle East as we welcome Manuel Hassassin, Palestinian representative to the UK. Please remember that some of those here will be more informed than others. Some will be familiar with some of the language being used, others will not. In light of this, please do try to consider the intent behind questions raised. Consider what the Union stands for, and remember that this is a valuable opportunity to question someone we wouldn't ordinarily get to meet. In the Q&A segment of this evening, I'd like to remind everyone to allow the flow of questions to continue. If you aren't content with the answer given to your question, we would ask that you please refrain from pursuing the question further, as we want to make sure that as many people as possible have the chance to get their questions heard. So, if we could please have a round of applause for Manuel Hassassin.
Thank you very much. I didn't hear what she said, but let me
start
by thanking you. This is not the first time I'm here at Cambridge. I've been here a couple of times. This is my third time, so I'm very familiar with the ambiance and with the type of students. And always when I come to Cambridge or to Oxford, I reminisce that I'm first a professor before being, you know, a diplomat or an ambassador. So it gives me great privilege to be with you today to discuss an issue that is considered to be one of the most intricate and complex issues in modern history, i.e. the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. Now, I was not, you know, told exactly what to talk about, so I have the privilege of trying basically to put into perspective, you know, the whole conflict, the essence of the conflict, and how do we move forward in trying to solve this conflict by using plausible methods of negotiations, political accommodation, inclusion, and what have you. You know, sometimes, you know, I start by defining this conflict, you know. In the theories of conflict management and resolution, we always say that the Palestinian-Israeli conflict is a protracted conflict. It's a conflict between two epistemic communities that have been embroiled, you know, in fighting each other over the same piece of land. And that piece of land used to be Palestine until, you know, around the 19th century, when we started witnessing, you know, Jewish immigration into Palestine, facilitated, you know, by the British mandate, especially, you know, with the infamous Balfour Declaration of 1917, where, you know, the Jewish diaspora Jews were promised a national home in Palestine. And it happens that next year there will be the marking of the centenary of the Balfour Declaration, 1917-2017. And, you know, sometimes it irritates us when we see that the present government, you know, is willing to mark the centenary of the Balfour Declaration, which reminds us of the historic and immoral justice that has been committed against the Palestinian people by trying to give a land that is not belonging to the British Empire to a people that did not have a land, actually, living in the diaspora as Jews. Now, the Jewish problem started with Europe, with the pogroms, with the Holocaust, and what have you, and we, the Palestinians, had to pay the price of being uprooted from our ancestral homes to end up living in diaspora, where, you know, Jewish immigration to Palestine, and eventually, you know, the subsequent wars that took place in 1948, where Israel declared basically the establishment of the State of Israel. And in 1967, another war broke out where Israel took the remaining parts of historic Palestine. So we're talking about today a complete 5 million people living under Israeli occupation. And to talk about occupation is basically very repulsive, because occupation is ugly and it violates and breaches international humanitarian law, let alone human rights. And Palestinians are living under dire economic conditions, under political conditions that are unbearable, because of the fact that we are there as captive, living in open-air prison camps in the West Bank, let alone in Gaza, that has been under siege for the last 10 years. Imagine 2 million people living in such a short, small strip of land where it is over-congested. It is the most populated, over-congested you know, strip in the world where we have almost 2 million people living there, and imagine under siege and under total, you know, control by the Israelis by land, air, and sea. Of course, basic human rights are being denied for the Palestinians there. They can't have medicine, they can't have food, and what have you. So this is the occupation that is considered to be a badge of dishonor to the international community, because this is one of the longest occupations in modern history. And it is a shame to talk about human rights and a global village when you have still Palestinians are struggling for the basic simple right, which is the right to self-determination. And to talk about democracy and the openness of societies and integration, the politics of inclusion, it sounds so nice rhetorically to the ear, but when it comes to practice, we don't see that neither from Europe nor from the United States. We are considered to be fourth-class citizens living, you know, under Israeli rule, where we don't have a say-so for our, you know, daily lives, let alone our economy is totally captive. Of course, we don't control our borders. We don't control our, basically, villages and cities. And I don't want to go into the history of the conflict, because it will take a lot of time to do that. But suffice it to say that today, if you go to the West Bank, you can't see the West Bank geographically contiguous, for the simple fact that three major clusters of settlements have divided the West Bank to the point where there is no geographic contiguity. To add injury to insult, basically, or insult to injury, is to see another 600 basic military checkpoints that prohibits Palestinians the sense of mobility from one village to another, from one city to another. Then when we talk about a two-state solution and see that Gaza is totally isolated, you know, under, you know, the Israeli control, and you see Jerusalem, which is East Jerusalem, is part of the Palestinians' territories that have been occupied in 1967, is totally isolated, totally sealed off by the E1 envelope settlement. And to see the West Bank not geographically contiguous, and then to hear, you know, this concept of a two-state solution all the time, it's impossible. How could we have a two-state solution when the West Bank is totally divided, when East Jerusalem is not part of the Arab, you know, territories, and when Gaza is totally separated? So what kind of a two-state solution are we talking about here? I came with a terminology. Today, we cannot talk about a two-state solution. We talk about two-state delusion. And when we talk about two-state delusion, what are the other options that we have, basically, as Palestinians to pursue our national aspirations, our achievement of self-determination, what have you? Israel is cornering us to the point where we have to start demanding a one democratic secular state. And the one democratic secular state for us Palestinians means one man, one vote, or one woman, one vote. I don't like to sound too gender here, but this is what we mean by, you know, a democratic secular state. Of course, you know, we have made our painful concession in 1988 in the 19th Palestinian National Council, where we have agreed that political accommodation and not military is the solution to our conflict. We have given up on armed struggle, and we have approached this conflict from a different new strategy, the strategy of peaceful coexistence, negotiations, and political accommodation with the State of Israel. It just happened that we had the Madrid Peace Conference, which took place as a result, you know, of the Gulf War, where President Bush Sr. have asked for this big fanfare gathering, you know, in Madrid, where, you know, the Israelis refused adamantly to be part and parcel of that peace process. But of course, at that time, Secretary Baker told them, whether you jump on the bandwagon or you will be left behind. And at that time, Israel was asking for $10 billion loan from the United States. The United States could use that trump card in pushing them to come to the peace process. So when we ask, you know, the Americans, why can't you put pressure? They keep on saying, no, we can't put pressure. You know, Israelis, are difficult. No, they can't put pressure. When they put the pressure on Shamir at that time, who was the prime minister, to go to Madrid, and they told him, if you don't come, we won't give you the 10 billion loan guarantees, he came to Madrid. So the Americans have the tools of putting pressures on Israel, but it is for their ulterior motives. You know, they're not putting pressures on the state of Israel. So the Americans have been a big flop in this peace process. For the last 22 years, they could not basically broker peace between the Palestinians and the Israelis. And if I talk about negotiations, I talk about the negotiations between two partners to the conflict, supposedly, that are not on equitable level. They're not on parity. There is a top dog, there is an underdog, and unfortunately, the third party has been unequivocally supporting the top dog over the underdog. So in the final analysis, I have been involved in the negotiations, and I led like 52 second-track negotiations, let alone I was in charge of the Jerusalem fight at Camp David. All the negotiations that we had were considered to be political diktat. It's the power politics that was imposed on the Palestinians, and nothing that we came into an agreement was as a result of open negotiations between us and the Israelis. It was always imposed upon us through the diktat of power politics. So there were no negotiations, my friends. Okay? It was always a one-way street. Talking about, you know, the European role, for example, the Europeans have always been payers and not players in this peace process. You know, they try to compensate for their sense of guilt by giving us pittance. Pittance. Pittance in the context of infrastructural development, human rights, giving NGOs money to do some people-to-people organizations to get together civil society and this and that. But they have never been actively involved in the political process. And I always tell them, you know, you don't show political teeth. Political teeth meaning that you should put pressure on the United States of America that this peace process cannot, if it's not based on equilibrium, on tete-a-tete negotiations, with no preconditions and no strings attached, we will never get the white smoke as the Vaticans do when they elect a pope. It will be always the black smoke, meaning that there is no agreement and we never reach any kind of an agreement. Israel is very comfortable in the way it's handling, you know, the occupied territories. Israel today, you know, is considered to be a power to reckon with in the Middle East, totally supported by the United States. By the way, Israel does not care about Europe because Europe for Israel is not the power that could rely on, and this is due to bilateral relations, basically. But the Europeans have never recognized the state of Palestine, not this, except Sweden that came outright and said, we are not going to succumb to the pressures of the Americans, neither to the Israelis. So they were the only ones who recognized us as a state, as governments. Now, if you talk about parliamentarians, most European parliamentarians, starting with the UK, have recognized us since the year 2012 and 2013. However, our problem is with the governments of the Europeans and not with the people. And I can attest to the fact, when I came to this country in the year 2005, there were 30% in public opinion were supporting the Palestinians. 70% were supporting the state of Israel. Now, after almost 10 years being here, I can see the difference jumped from 30% basically to 70%. So there is quite a dramatic, I would say even a draconian change in the public opinion in the UK. And we have seen, you know, a lot of support coming at the popular level, at the parliamentarians level, but not on the government level. So there is a problem there. And you see, the thing is, people always misunderstand what is happening today in the Arab world. Yes, it is very tragic, especially if you follow what is happening in Syria. You know, what is happening there is something beyond imagination. The killing, the rebels, I mean, something sometimes I really fail to rationalize what is happening there. It is so unfortunate that Syria became the playground of international politics, where big powers are trying to settle scores in Syria at the expense of innocent civilians. The destruction of Aleppo, the destruction of Damascus, Idlib, and all these cities, you know, in Syria, is one of the most tragic that is happening besides Palestine that has been going on for the last 100 years. But today we are seeing, you know, also dramatic changes in the Arab world. And what is happening in Tunisia, in Yemen, in Libya, it is so tragic. But at the same time, I must say these are transient phenomena. One day, things are going to settle there. But I tell you, settling there does not mean that there will be peace and security and stability in the Middle East. I must be here selfish enough to tell you, and this is not because I'm a Palestinian, but this is, you know, the objective true truth, as we say, is that without resolving the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, there will never be peace and security and stability in the Middle East. Now, regardless, we're talking today about a chaotic, anarchic, turbulent Middle East because of so many fightings and revolutions and what have you, and with the advent of Daesh, ISIL, and what have you, things are becoming more ugly in the Middle East. But I tell you, frankly speaking, when we talk about what is happening today in the Middle East, the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, the non-resolution is a major factor to the rise of terrorism, abject poverty, and what have you. We have to bear in mind that extremism is taking shape because of the non-solution of the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. Now, it is unfortunate sometimes Islamic, you know, militant groups, they use the Palestinian issue sometimes as a facade for their own ulterior motives. Nobody, I mean, just to give excuses, for example. But we are not on their mind, neither on their agenda. And that's why, you know, I don't have respect to militants who are trying to use the Palestinian problem for their own ulterior motive. If they want to liberate Palestine, ahlan wa sahlan, we say, let them come to Palestine and liberate us from Israeli occupation. Israel has not even been touched. Israel more safer than ever now, even with what's happening in the Middle East. I'm not talking about, you know, the total security arrangements that were made between the Palestinian Authority and that of Israel as part of the Oslo agreements. And that total collaboration for the last, I would say, 9 to 10 years when President Abu Mazen was elected, we have seen total collaboration on security matters. So there is no need for Israel to always use security as an excuse not to push the peace process forward. Because that has been an obsession. Obsession of a siege mentality. Israel is living like in a garrison state today. They think that, you know, everybody's going to jump on it and push her into the sea and what have you. This garrison mentality is making Israel a pariah state. And that's not the true facts on the ground. Israel wants to be put in that position in order to gain the sympathy of the international community. Nobody can keep on talking about anti-Semitism, you know, when they criticize Israel. We are Semites. We Palestinians are Semites. And what Israel is doing to the Palestinians under occupation is anti-Semitism. It's not the criticizing of Israel policies as an occupying force is anti-Semitism. You're criticizing, you know, because of the breach of international humanitarian laws. People criticize Israel for its breach of human rights, in not giving the Palestinians the right to self-determination. We have embarked on this arduous, tormentuous path of what we call the Oslo peace process. What did we achieve since 1994? More settlements have been built. We have today almost 680,000 settlers in the West Bank, let alone around the environs of Jerusalem, we have almost 250,000 settlers. And then how are we going to solve the issue of settlements. More than 120 settlements you have in the occupied territories today. And most of the settlers are only 10% of the population of Israel. And those are driven by the ideology that this is Eretz Israel, this is the biblical prophecy, it was given to them by God. As if God is a real estate agent, giving, you know, Israel the privilege of having that kind of property. I always say, if God is a real estate agent, I don't want to believe in this God. I know God is spiritual, forgiving, omnipresent, omniscient, and this is how I was raised as a Christian Catholic. I was not raised to know God favors one people over the other. This is racism and bigotry and cannot be accepted. So such ideological interpretations are no more valid when it comes to the concept of pragmatism, that is choosing between constraints. We have to be practical people. In the year 2002, because I said there will never be a military solution to our conflict, Israelis from an Apache hit me and my family in the house with a TOW missile that exploded the entire house. We were lucky that we were at the end of the house at that time, so we survived the calamity. My house was blown into the air because I said on television, there will never be a military solution to this conflict. And read my lips, ladies and gentlemen. Israel has won every single war in the Middle East. But did it bring security to its own individuals? No. Security cannot come by brutal force. Security comes by giving the rights to others. And we are not going to take it just as granted. We are going to snatch it from the horse's mouth. It's our right. We made our historic concession, and a painful one, when we said, yes, we recognize the state of Israel, over 78% of Palestine. That this is the state of Israel, we recognize it. And now to come and share 22%, what is left to talk about, you know, an independent Palestinian state? People ask me, what do you think now the repercussions or the ramifications of the election of Trump over the Middle East issue, in particular the Palestinians? Maybe you have seen so many videos during the electoral campaign saying that Israel is considered to be one of the member states of the United States, maybe the 51 state, and referring to them as Republican Israelis. This is the speech of Pence when he talked about the vice president, when he talked about his relationship basically to Israel. I tell you frankly, for me it doesn't matter whether Clinton came or Trump, for the simple fact I consider them Tweedledum, Tweedledee. There is no basic difference between Democrats and Republicans when it comes to the state of Israel and when it comes to the interest, the national interest of the United States in the Middle East. And I have made extensive analysis on American foreign policy since Eisenhower's administration up today. And I tell you, my friends, it has always been based on four cornerstones that have not been changed. One is the unequivocal support of the so-called bastion of democracy as a strategic asset to the national interests of the Americans and as the source of discordance and instability in the Middle East area by creating the state of Israel. That's number one. Number two, the accessibility of oil. Make sure that there is always oil accessible to the United States and, of course, with the control of the markets in the Middle East. Number three used to be the containment of communism, because communism as an ideology since MacArthur and the communists after the Second World War has always been a nightmare. Democrats are the good guys, the Bolsheviks, and the communists are the bad guys. So we have been grown on the balance of power between the two superpowers, you know, fighting each other. But in 1988, when the Soviet Union crumbled as a result of Glasnost and Perestroika, what we ended having is a unipolar power, i.e. the United States. But you see, the Americans cannot nourish and cannot survive. They are like vultures, they survive of conflict. When the Soviet Union has crumbled, they created a new enemy, and that enemy was Islamic fundamentalism. And fourthly, they always managed to give protection and assistance to Arab proxy regimes in the area and to curb any kind of national liberation movement. And these are the four cornerstones that Americans have been when it comes to foreign policy in the Middle East. So you tell me, what changes have we witnessed during Barack Obama, and what are our anticipation when we see Trump? They have the same ulterior motives in the Middle East. One is very diplomatic, conceals and tries not to show the true colors of the Americans in the region. And the other is very transparent, like Trump, very transparent. As a matter of fact, you know, I would be more comfortable dealing with Trump than dealing with Hillary Clinton, frankly speaking. And I can say that not as a Palestinian, but as an American who did not vote in these elections because I thought that the United States now is at the apex of its political degeneracy. If they have these two candidates to represent such a powerful country, I think there is a big problem in that part of the world. And talking about leadership, there is a crisis of international leadership, ladies and gentlemen. We don't have charismas of Nasser, Nehru, and Tito, and all these big, you know, big names in history that maintained nationalism, communism, ideologies that really ruled over many decades with stability. When did we realize, and when did we face the Arab Spring and what have you? It's all after the crumbling of the Soviet Union, when the Americans came to power as being the unipolar power controlling the universe. They became the police of the entire international community. We started witnessing religious strifes, sectarian problems, ethnic problems, and what have you. This is what we have witnessed for the last two decades. We have not witnessed stability and security. Of course, within this context, Israel is really at ease. They don't have any economic problems, thanks to the United States of America, that has signed a deal of $38 billion in terms of a package military aid to Israel. Thanks to Europe that have open trade relations with no strings attached, no tariffs on Israeli products, and even they try to give the green light for the Israelis to sell their settlement products. Settlement products are considered illegal because those territories are illegal. And selling properties, you know, commodities from the settlements is a total breach of international conventions and treaties. Israel is doing it. And Israel pays no heed. 138 countries have recognized the state of Palestine. Israel did not mind it. As long as there is a veto power by the United States, they care less about the entire international. So Israel is considered to be the most militarized country in the Middle East. Israel has no problem in winning conventional wars against all the Arabs put together. So Israel is in the driver's seat. However, can Israel live in peace? Can Israel live in tranquility? Can Israel close their eyes and not being alert that there are 5 million Palestinians earnestly waiting to have their own self-determination and independence? I think this paranoia that is evolving with Israeli politics, you know, will be always a constant reminder that Israel is not safe, Israel is not secure. And I tell you, the safety and security of Israel comes with the solution to the Palestinian problem. It comes when they acknowledge the fact that the relinquishing of occupied territories to the Palestinians is the salvation of the Jewish nation and the salvation of the state of Israel. And I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, 50 years down the pipeline, Is the United States of America going to continue to be the basic supporter of Israel? Or is it going to be continuing as the superpower? Nobody knows, no guarantees. Nobody expected the crumbling of the Soviet Union, that big empire after 70 years. So there is no guarantee that the U.S. will continue to be the angel, protecting angel of Israel. 1.2 billion Muslims in the world today, and there will be 1.5, are not going to accept the desecration of the holy sites by the Israelis. The Arabs are going to overcome what we call the Arab Spring. And one day there will come a leader where Arabs will be united. The Palestinians are not going to revisit the 1948 Nakba. They're not going to accept the forceful diasporization, even if genocide is being committed against them. So if we take all these factors and try to look at the future, what does Israel have? Israel cannot continue living in a state of belligerency. Israel cannot continue to be in a state of bellicosity, always thinking about the Arabs and the Muslims as warmongers. They cannot survive the psychological pressures. And today, believe me, every single Israeli needs a shrink. We also need shrinks because we have been suffering under occupation. It's unfortunate that we cannot afford it, but they can afford it. But this doesn't mean that they are living in peace and harmony and security within themselves. I'm not going to delve into the contradictions of Israeli society, but all I must say today is the fact that Israel will never have peace unless it relinquishes the West Bank, Gaza, and East Jerusalem. And we can talk about occupation and what occupation has created, you know, in the Arab world, in the Muslim world, and even among Palestinians. Every generation that we have today, they're becoming more adamant, more resolute in continuing the struggle against Israel. Now, I stand here in front of you as a peace advocate. I don't believe in violence because violence breeds violence. I don't believe in military solution because military solution will bring catastrophe on both sides. I say, let's spare our human lives. The only way out is negotiations. But the true negotiations comes with the fact that you are there to respect the other as a partner to your conflict, to expect the other's needs for security and safety. You cannot have negotiations only with one side and the other side is not responding. It's like clapping, but in the context of Zen Buddhism, you know? It cannot work out, ladies and gentlemen. There has to be a deep conviction that the only way out is through political accommodation. I have learned this history back almost 20, 25 years ago. And I have participated in all kinds of resistance when I was a kid. Now I come to the belief and to the conviction that we cannot continue with the same old mentalities of fighting each other. But I tell you also, our steadfastness, our resolute to stand, fight, and to continue our battle. And I always advocate peaceful resistance, nonviolent resistance to occupation. Because that's the only way that we can, in one way or another, reach an agreement. There should be a politics of inclusion. We have not paid attention enough into the peace-building process. We have not created the culture of inclusion and acceptance. We have not changed our perceptions, cognitions, and mores in the context of accepting the other. It has to be a balanced, it has to be mutual. And I always say, this conflict has always been shaped by two factors, historically. One factor is the mutual distrust, and the second factor is mutual fear. If we have distrust and fear, we will never reach any conclusion. because that is a recipe for disaster, for violence. Maybe you have not heard such, you know, a perspective coming from a Palestinian, but believe me, I reflect the psyche and the mentality and the rhetoric of the Palestinian people who are adamantly craving for peace, stability, and security. We don't want to see our children who are being incarcerated every day, 8 years, 9 years, put in prisons. Who accepts that? A kid of 8 years being incarcerated and put in jail and prison? Who wants to see that? Why not talk about these issues? Why do we keep on talking about the security of Israel? What about the security of the Palestinians? We are the unarmed. We are the ones under occupation. Nobody talks about the children. Nobody talks, you know, about pregnant women who cannot reach the hospitals and deliver at the checkpoints because the Israeli soldiers are not allowing them to go to the hospitals in Jerusalem. And if I give you examples like this, you will understand what it means, daily humiliation and suffering of the Palestinian people. And I'm not here to give demagogic speeches. I'm giving realities. And if you want to be blind to these realities, then there is something wrong with the international conscience. This is how I approach the issue. I invite each and every one of you to go and visit Palestine and Israel. And I'm sure you will come back better ambassadors than Manuel Hassassian. Thank you very much. Okay, time wise.
Feel free to take a seat or to sit down. Manuel, thank you so much. So I'd just like to open up to audience questions. If you have a question, if you could just raise your hand and wait for a microphone. Yes. If we go to the gentleman at the back, since Nancy's there. Nancy, have you got a microphone? Thanks, Nancy. It's all right.
Hello, and thank you very much for those interesting, important words. Of course, I acknowledge the central issue that negotiations between oppressor and oppressed are meaningless. But having said that, do you see any way in which Hamas and Fatah can become closer together so that there's a more united front within the Palestinians? And I know that some people feel that Mahmoud Abbas, leader of Fatah, is too close to the Israeli authorities. I wonder if you could comment on those two things, please.
Can I stand?
Yes, of course.
Thank you very much. You know, when I was a student of politics, my first class at the American University of Beirut back in 1973, I have learned in politics that there is nothing absolute, my friend. There is no zero-sum conflict because the world has changed. And I have learned that pragmatism is choosing between constraints. As I said, we have tried armed struggle. By armed struggle, we became considered terrorists, fighting for our land, fighting for the pride of our people. We were dubbed as terrorists. So we said we're not going to use terrorism and not resistance. But people still hail the French resistance to Nazi Germany during what we call les batailles de résistance. That was okay then. But today, the Palestinian resistance is terrorism. It's so unfortunate. We said, yes, let us change our strategies. We accept the state of Israel, and we negotiate on the pullout of the Israelis to the 1967 borders. And we have UN Security Councils, resolutions 242 and 338. And we have many other Security Council resolutions that embolden the withdrawal of Israel because it defined it as the acquisition of territory by force. All right? So we made our concessions, and we have agreed to become embarking on what we call the Oslo peace process, where P peace and security to Israel will be in total equivalence with the independence of the Palestinian and having a Palestinian state. So security collaboration was part and parcel. But of course, since nothing happened, we became the authority quislings. We became collaborators, traitors. And this is how the Palestinians and Arabs, others who are in opposition, perceive the pragmatism of such a government. Because we are the weaker side in this, you know, equation, and because we don't want to embark on something that proved to be futile, we decided to opt into negotiations and politics. As far as Hamas and Fatah is concerned, you know, when this topic is opened, my heart bleeds, my friend. Because before being a diplomat, I used to be the president of a university called Bethlehem University. It is a Catholic-sponsored university where we have 75% of our students are Muslims, 25% are Christians. You know what is the emblem, our sign? In Latin, in divis amanent. In divis amanent, meaning united we stand and divided we fall. I come from that background. I come from that background that, you know, factionalism, factorization, atomization of my society is not going, basically, to bear fruition when it comes even to resistance or to negotiations. We have to be united firmly on one political platform, on one flag, and on one state. And that state is the democratic state of Palestine. Now, for the last almost, I would say, 8 years, Gaza was occupied by a coup d'etat by Hamas. Immediately after, when we had, you know, our national unity government, Hamas withdrew from the national unity government and orchestrated this coup d'etat and took over Gaza. You have to understand, Hamas does not have a national agenda alone. Hamas is part and parcel of the Muslim Brotherhood. And if you go and study the ideology of Muslim Brotherhood, is having the Islamic State in the Arab world first and then spread it all over, meaning reminiscing the Islamic caliphate, all right? That's why these are the oxymoron of nationalism, where you go to internationalism by using the ideology of religion. And that's why, you know, there will never be a total reconciliation on the ideological platform because we are totally opposite. We are at loggerheads. However, our unity should be tied to the fact that we should get rid of occupation, work together, and have our independent Palestinian state. Afterwards, elections, ballots and not bullets that should basically decide the outcome of our fate in the future. Now, everybody says, oh, Hamas and Fatah, Hamas and Fatah. Also, Israel is divided. Do you think everybody, you know, is with this coalition government? Do you think everybody is with the settlers? I have Israeli friends who refuse to go and visit their friends in the settlers, in the settlements. You know, Israel society also is divided. I tell you, my friend, when this is what I call political jingoism, when the religious factor becomes the prime factor in the conflict, it gives it a new twist and a new dimension. And that dimension, believe me, would definitely lead to violence. And I can see violence coming down the pipeline. Because it's unfortunate that the peripheries on both societies are becoming the fulcrum of decision-making rather than the mainstreams. The mainstreams became peripheralized with no power of decision-making over the fate of Palestine and Israel. But yet we become the victims of extremism on both sides. And that's why we're telling Mr. Netanyahu, wake up. Wake up, my dear friend, wake up. Because you're not going to know exactly from where the blow is going to come at the end of the day. This is the time. I always tell my Israeli friends, you know, professors who are in peace now, extreme leftists, liberal, and what have you. I say, In politics, in negotiations, when do we concede? And I hate the word concession. I hate the word concession. But when do we concede? We concede when we are at the crescendo of politics, power politics. You don't concede when you are weak. You should concede when you are strong. And that kind of concession brings you stability and security, because still you have the magic wand in changing, you know, the rules of the game. You don't concede when you are defeated. And this is what I tell my Israeli friend. This is the time where you have to understand the political realities. You cannot continue to claim being the bastion of democracy in the Middle East while you are the only occupier country left in the world. This has to end. And the sooner the better, because I can see it coming very ugly. Thank you.
Do we have another question? Yes, gentleman with scarf in the middle row.
Hello. Thank you very much for your speech. You've already implied the link between American and Western interest in the Middle East and the oil wealth of that region. How do you anticipate the declining oil wealth of that region into the 2050s and 60s, the scarcity of oil? How do you anticipate that will affect Western interest in the Middle East and specifically the possibility of a solution in Palestine?
This is a very smart question and a very challenging one. You know, sometimes I sit with myself. You know, self-criticism is very important. All right? I always said, I wish we did not have oil in the Middle East. The destruction that we have today is because of that oil. And it is so unfortunate that that oil is not being distributed to the people of the Middle East. It's in the hands of oligarchs, those who are in power. In the year 2050, I totally agree with you. The oil resources are going to be totally depleted. And I always say, it's good to go back to your roots and live as Bedouins under the tent, because at least we had peace, tranquility, and we don't have the Western invaders to come anymore to our country. I think that will be the time where people start thinking, what the hell are we doing in that desert? Why do we need these camel riders? We don't need them anymore. And just to give you one example, you think the United States of America needs our oil in the Middle East? They're self-sufficient, my friend. They did not even use the reserves. And Dania, she is a reporter. She knows about economics of the Gulf, and she knows exactly about oil and what is going to happen when the depletion of oil resources is happening. And today, America is leading, you know, the fissions of what we call alternative energy. All right? Do you think the Soviet Union need oil or gas? They are among the richest in the world. The only ones who are selling their oil, and that is going to be depleted, are the Arabs, my friend. So using the oil of the Arabs by depleting them and getting their own reserved oil, not even touched, all right, will prompt tomorrow the Americans, the Europeans, to leave the Middle East. Because if you don't have money, you don't have markets. What the West has been doing, give money to get the finite resource and then sell weapons and sell finished products. In other words, the compilation of all the capital in the Arab world, it ends up back in Chase Manhattan and in the banks of the United States. Because even the Arabs, they don't trust to basically try to build infrastructures in the Arab world, to invest in the Arab world. Because they are always under the impression that investing in unstable conditions is not going to get them the remuneration that they want. So they invest all the money. America gives the money, and the money goes back in investments in American banks. So who is gaining here? We're losing our oil, and the Americans are getting back their money. And what is America doing? and the Western world, they're just, you know, printing paper money. They give us paper money and they take our finite resources. And they never allow us to develop. They never allow us to produce our own commodities. They made all our economics totally dependent on the Western markets, on the Western economics. And that's why I cannot see any development. My friend, don't go to Dubai and see all these fancy buildings. An economy is not really based on consumption. An economy is always based on production, my friend. If you don't produce, you don't become politically independent.
I think we've got time for one more question. Yes, gentleman in the checkered shirt.
Thank you very much for coming to speak with us. I had a question concerning Hebron and the situation with the settlements and Palestinians living on each other's doorstep. And when I went, from a Western media perspective, I was horrified at what I saw, and that I had never seen it before. And my question is, how is it possible that this can be going on and that it's not resonating in the Western media, and what can be done about that?
When I go to Hebron, I may be horrified more than you. To see 450 settlers in the old city of Hebron are controlling the whole city, where it is inhabited by 350,000 Palestinians. And what horrifies me is not the arrogance of the settlers who act as gunslingers. If you remember in the movies Dodge City, this is how they act in the city of Hebron, totally supported by the Israeli offensive forces. I don't call it defensive, it's not IDF, it's IOF, my friend. Okay? And to take over the old quarter in Hebron, where so many shops have been closed for so many years now because they are not allowed to go and open their shops. Why? Because settlers have houses there that they took by sheer force under the pretext of religion. And being supported by the state, by the Israeli government, to let them act as hoodlums in that part of the city, it is terrifying. This is where violence is, my friend. You can see people with their children passing by the Israeli settlers, throwing rocks at them, spitting on them, hitting them, slapping them, while the Israeli soldier is there, seeing what's happening, and that Israeli settler is totally armed with Kalashnikovs and M16s and K16s and what have you, and he is there, alert, ready, if the Palestinian resists or makes something else. I don't see any solution to the Hebron situation without seeing a solution to the entire conflict. There will never be a solution to Hebron. Israelis, Kiryat Arba, which is one of the most fanatic Israeli settlers living there, every day they come, they burn orchards, they kidnap Palestinians, they humiliate them, they kill them, they burn their cars and what have you. Do you think that such acts of violence by Israel is going to scare the Palestinians? They're not going to leave, my friend. They're not going to leave. And as you can see also, there is a Palestinian reaction to this. You know? And that reaction is going to be maximized. The more violence you will have, the fierce reaction is going to come from the underdog. But I totally agree with you. It's horrifying. I wish, you know, the people of Hebron don't go through the process of humiliation, fear, and living within this siege mentality that the settlers are at the doors threatening them. And every day, maybe you hear on the news, but it is so unfortunate that the mainstream in this country is not covering, as we say in French, la vie quotidienne du Palestinien. They're not covering the daily sufferings of the Palestinians. You know, you ask me, as an ambassador, when I was interviewed by the BBC, I tell you, over a year and a half, I was not on BBC television. You know where you can find me speaking? On Russia Today. On Russia Today. Where is the mainstream journalism in this country? You don't have it. It's so shameful. You know, the last interview I had with CNN was the war over Gaza. One interview by Hala Gorani, who is a journalist, Syrian origin, who invited me one time to speak, imagine. And I used to be a regular visitor to CNN. Not anymore. So all this, you know, control of the media does not really expose to you what the Palestinians are going through. And I'm not here to tell you stories and anecdotes, you know, about how people suffer under occupation. Because sometimes you bring people from overseas, peasants, very simple people, who describe their daily lives. I can bring you students who can describe, you know, how they have to cross through the mountains to avoid checkpoints to go to their university, let alone school kids. Takes them 4 to 5 hours back and forth to go to their school. This is suffering, my friend. This is humiliation. People don't know about these things because it's not covered in the press. All is covered with suicide bombing. Oh, my goodness. When there is a suicide bombing, my phone at home rings at 2 in the morning. I'm being hassled. I'm being harassed by the press to come and talk because they want to pin me down. But when Israel commits atrocious crimes against the Palestinians, nobody is willing to hear the ideas of the ambassadors and what he has to say. So unfortunate.
Manuel, thank you so, so much. It's been a fantastic event.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Wonderful. Thank you so, so much.
My pleasure.